So good morning to you all. My name is Lucas Evangelista. I'm talking from Manaus, Brazil. That means I'm talking inside the Amazon forest in Brazil. And today I'm going to talk about the short-term effects of weight initialization functions in deep neuroevolution. I'm currently a master's student in the graduate program in computer science, or PPGE here in Brazil, from the Federal University of Amazonas, UFAM. And another author of this paper is my advisor, Professor Rafael Giusti. And it is a great honor for both of us to present our work and our results here in the late break abstract session in Evostar 2021. Well, as the title says, we are going to talk about weight initializer or parameter initializers in deep neuroevolution. And we are going to talk about two big important papers that come in 2010-2015 that introduced to us the glutaric activation, also called the exhibitor activation and the reactivation. And when we talk about weight initialization functions, we have to think they are a very important decision when we are building, constructing, and designing a neural network, especially when we're talking about deep models, because in your era, it's easy to talk about deep models because we have the computational power from a GPU, a robust CPU, and et cetera. And at the time, between 2010 and 2015, a deep neural network were considered to have at least 8 layers. So again, it's easy for us to talk about the size of layers when you have so much computational power in your days. And at the same time, we have the deep neural evolution algorithms, so the biosparrow techniques that we can use to help us to select the best individuals, the best architectures, and help select the other parameters and high parameters, for example, the number of epochs, callbacks, and etc. And when we talk about deep neural evolution algorithms, there is some special techniques that comes along. For example, Professor Ken Stanley NEAT, HyperNEAT, also CoDeepNEAT from Professor McLinen. They also created NEAT with Professor Ken Stanley by 2002. We have some reinforcement learning approach, Dancer from Professor Nuno Lourenço and his team in Portugal, and etc. But at the same time, he in this paper are going to ask a very simple question, but at the same time, very interesting one. That is, how do current standard weight initialization functions help indeed the convergence or help in any way? They are an architecture that at the same time created by the deep neural evolution algorithm, but at the same time has its architecture always changing. So we want to understand how those two weight initializers that we talked before can help those neural networks, because both of them, the exhibitor activation, the reactivation, were created for a neural network that has its architecture fixed. So we want to understand better how those weight initializers can affect when we talk about evolutionary run. And we also are going to address about the short-term effect, because when we talk about deep neural evolution, we are talking about sometimes, unfortunately, an approach that is very time consuming, because we have to evolve neural network, we have to train them, we have to have a lot of them in generations, we have to find the best one by the fitness functions and etc. So the time required to evolve all those networks, all those individuals, may hinder in difficult reproducibility, and is for all of us in the research area a challenging for do again the data and even enter the research area, because we don't have the high computational power to do it. So in this paper, in this work you are presenting right now, we aim to address this question at the same time about the reactivation, glutaric activation, and how they affect deep neural evolution, considering a short-term effect. So instead of using 100 generations, 1,000 individuals, we are going to use a very small number that we're going to show in a moment. And of course, now with multiple weight initializations. And to help answer these questions or this experiment, at least we are going to use the CoDeepNEAT from Professor McLinen that we said before, that create and neural networks and evolve individuals with blueprints and modules. We can think blueprints as the relations between layers. We have convolutional layer. We may have a max pooling, a batch normalization, etc. Blueprints talks about the relation between layers. And we have those chunks of blueprints. And then we have also as individuals evolving modules. Modules are the relations between blueprints. So we have chunks of layers. They are gathered, united, and you have modules creating the connections between them. In an easy way to think about modules is they are like, they give us the opportunity to create skip connections between those blueprints and mixing together blueprints and modules. We can assemble a neural network. Instead, we are going to create multiple neural networks with blueprints and modules. And here is a methodology. We are going to use the CIFAR-10 dataset, the MNIST dataset with CoDeepNEAT. We are just choosing those two datasets because they are very easy to find. We can use them in many framework, deep learning frameworks. We can use in FastAI, PyTorch, Keras, TensorFlow, and they are a benchmark dataset in your research area. And to avoid bias, we are going to run every weight initializer, especially the 401, Glorot normal, Glorot uniform, Hey normal, Hey uniform. And just a simple notice, we are going to use the accuracy as our main metric in the test set in CIFAR-10 and MNIST. Here we have some parameters to at the same time for CoDeepNEAT to evolve our neural networks from high parameters and parameters. In the first table, we have the node parameters. That means the parameters that are talking about our neural network, the final product. So we have number of filters, dropout rate, max pooling, batch normalization. In the second table, we have our evolutionary parameters. So we have generations, population size, module population size. So here we can see how we are going to try to emulate the short-term effect with less computational power. So we have five generations, five individuals per generation, and training each individual that is a neural network, you are going to train for only five generations. And the best individual in the end, we are going to train for 100 generations. I'm sorry, for 100 epochs. And we have other parameters, modular population size, mutation rate, blueprint population size, elitism rate, crossover rate. And here are our results. And everything we did with a low computational power. So we did with a 4 GB GPU. So it's very accessible. And every run here, Glorot normal, Glorot uniform, with CIFAR-10, MNIST, and also Renormal and Re-uniform for both datasets took about 41 to 42 hours, everyone. So every run here, you can see, took at least between 50 to 55 minutes. And we have in CIFAR-10 dataset, and the third one, almost 81%, the Glorot uniform, almost 85%, the MNIST run, for Glorot normal 99%, the Glorot uniform 99.14%, and for the Hey normal we have the best almost 80%, the Hey uniform almost also 80%, for the Hey normal in this data set we have 99.21%, the Hey uniform 99.23%, and indeed those results are not among the state of art performances, but we have those results with a short term effect, so they help us to understand how those weight initializers affect the evolutionary process. So in fact, we may not have the best results in the area, but we did have those results in less than an hour for each run. So we have between 25 to 30 minutes for the evolutionary run. And then when we found the best individual, the best neural network, we trained for 100 epochs, and then the total process was less than an hour, like we say here. So we have almost 85% for the CIFAR-10 dataset and more than 99% in the MNIST dataset. And we say here, we have a slightly advantage for the Glorot uniform, the CIFAR dataset, very slightly, because we have almost 85%. And for the MNIST dataset, we didn't find no advantage between those initializers, because every initializer in every run got above 98%. And for our future work, we are now trying to understand how linear and nonlinear activations functions interact with different weight initializers during deep neural evolutionary run. So thank you very much. I'm open for questions.